I'm a struggling writer. And I was born in Sri Lanka and moved here after a couple of other countries in between. And really everything else is immaterial. Those are the facts, and that's what I contend with, you know? And the struggling part is no joke. I have another job I have to do full time to pay the bills, and this is something I do on my own, and it's, you know, I don't know. I just feel like there isn't enough time to really make such fine distinctions.
Well, I think I've sort of answered the question in my introduction. I guess I'm really a writer of two worlds. I mean, I feel very much of two worlds in that I'm equally comfortable in both places, and so that's always actually kind of oddly alienating, because if you felt slightly alienated in one place, especially like now when I've just come back from Sri Lanka, if I felt slightly alienated in Canada, if I felt it was even slightly foreign, that would be comforting in some way, but it isn't. It's just so familiar, I just slip right into it, which is nice. I'm not complaining about it. I just feel that it's sometimes just odd to suddenly stop and think, gosh, I was in Sri Lanka 2 weeks ago or whatever, and I was doing this, and so on and so forth.
Can I add? I mean, if you're interested in this question of sort of writerly identities, Salman Rushdie, who is not Sri Lankan, but he actually has some great little essays around this topic in his book of essays, Imaginary Homelands. So I recommend that to people.
We'd like to turn it over to the audience. So anybody who has a question, please raise your hand, and we'd really like to sort of get your thoughts and your questions in here. Right there, why don't you come on up?
Or be loud.
Okay, why don't you be loud?
Marianne, you were talking about, first of all, thank you for even sharing, I really but you were talking about the idea of getting it right, and how that's something that prevents you sometimes from moving forward with your writing. And I was just wondering, in this situation, and like amongst you and Robert, like, can anyone get it right? What would that feel like, and what would that look like?
So the question was whether, you know, the idea of getting it right.
So I have like three different answers to that, but I'll try to be brief. When I wrote Bodies in Motion, right, which was set in Sri Lanka, it starts in Sri Lanka in the 1940s, and it's sort of a novel in stories. It's like an epic family saga over three generations kind of thing. I was a grad student. I couldn't afford to go back. I wanted to, I couldn't find any funding, so I felt, and I hadn't been back in the country since 95, and so I just tried to check it with people as much as I could, right? And so I would write these stories, and I'd send them out, I would ask friends of mine who had been back recently to look at it, how am I doing? And they offered corrections. Specifically, I feel like I should know my three Jagadeesan, who is an academic and who goes to Sri Lanka and has done work in the camps, like, corrected some of my political elements. There's one of the stories, one of a Tamil girl runs off to join the Tigers, and it turns out that at that time, Prabhakaran wasn't accepting child soldiers at the time that story was set, and so but it was very helpful for, so I think that's important. I think, you know, as far as I know, I'm an academic and I've been working with this material for 20 years. As far as I know, I'm the first Sri Lankan American writer to publish, which is a terrible responsibility. I mean, it's just awful. And I wish there were 1,000 of us publishing, because then there would not be nearly as much temptation among readers to take my voice as being somehow authoritative, authentic, representative, etc. So if any of you want to write stories, publish them, you know, and I think that I suppose that's sort of my answer to getting it, like a multiple answer to getting it right. One, do your research, check your facts, don't knowingly promulgate errors of history, also encourage other writers, and specifically too, you know, I do as much as I can to promote writers from Sri Lanka, and I think that is another aspect of being a diaspora writer that I feel, I think there's a responsibility. facility for us to do that, because my voice is so amplified because I'm in the West, because I have access to the New York publishing scene, because I'm an academic, you know, whatever, right? There's this magnification. And I know writers like Ashok Ferry or Pradeep, they just don't have access in the same way. And so I say their names until you go buy their books, right?
I think, you know, I'd also be interested in Koom's thoughts on this, because it's a different kind of writing that you do, where you're not, you're really mining your own experiences. Do you feel any sort of pressure to, you know, get it right, or, you know, to be, you know, to do that sort of thing, sort of hit the right notes when you do so?
I try to remind myself that if I don't know what I'm writing about, then not to write it, even if I'm writing fiction. And I just draw on a lot of different sources. Like one Tamil writer I really like, and who's kind of fallen out of favor, is Indian Tamil, it's R.K. Narayan. Like when I first read him, it blew my mind because I grew up reading nothing like that. And he gets the voice, the Tamil voice, so spot on. And the sense of humor and the neuroses and the idiosyncrasies. So I think you just gotta draw on everything you can that kind of feels right, because you're really going, you're feeling your way through things.
Shyam, the sort of the mainstream appeal of your books, you know, it draws in a larger crowd than just the diaspora. Does that increase the pressure to sort of get it right, or is it just part of the process?
Well, I suppose for me, the books so far, this book that's coming out in August, as a different audience. But I mean, when I say audience, I mean, who am I addressing when I sit down to write? And so far, it's always been Sri Lankans living in Sri Lanka. So it's been very clear to me about what I mean, you know, getting it right is important. But I also think that there is such thing as poetic license, and that, you know, one shouldn't approach a work of fiction with a foot ruler, sort of saying, well, you know, realistically, you can't get from Kandy to Colombo in X amount of hours. So, or realistically, you know, blah, 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 because that's not what we're here for. You know, you have to give people some leeway. I mean, to the writer, the writers have a right to some leeway. It's just that the material in Sri Lanka is so serious that you can't afford to fudge serious stuff. I think that's more important. You can't afford to lie, you can't afford to whitewash the truth or to hide it in any ways. And I think also as a fiction writer, I feel a very strong commitment to complication, to making things complicated, to making things gray, because that's what you really can do as a fiction writer, you make things very gray.
Just a couple of thoughts off of that. I hesitate to name names because they're not here to talk about their work, but there are a variety of published writers in the field who are maybe Sri Lankan writers who are in direct conflict with each other. And so if you read, especially the ones writing nonfiction, if you read their essays, you will see them calling each other out and saying that's a lie and whatever else, right? And this is very charged material. It is, I think, really difficult to get away from what you learned as a kid and what, you know, my dad, along with, I think, all the other Sri Lankan Tamil parents in Connecticut when I was growing up, contributed to the Tigers, right? Let's support our boys, right? And then as the Tigers' methods changed, and people became more aware of what was happening with them, they became very conflicted and sad about how things had gone. And so I think it is incredibly complicated. But that's earlier I said that I feel very cautious writing about politics. I do want to also say, I don't think that absolves you from speaking. I think that even when you're scared of getting it wrong, it's important to be careful and do your research, but it is then do your best to like take a stand and figure out what you believe and then put it out there. And people may call you on it, people may argue with you, they may tell you you're wrong. If you've done your research, you can at least try to back up what you say, and maybe you'll find you are wrong, and then you learn from that and go on. You know, I mean, this is, I mean, if we're going to talk about reconciliation, we have to talk about the fact that we have deeply held histories and beliefs and practices that are going to be in conflict at times. And I don't think we can just ignore that and expect to get to true reconciliation. I think we have to fight it out with words.
I do want to get to another question from the audience, but you touched on an interesting point. What role does storytelling and fiction and nonfiction, what role can that play in reconciliation and healing and sort of and that sort of thing? I'd like to sort of get your thoughts on that.
Someone.
I really don't know, to be honest with you. I can't answer.
Well, I mean, I think the gentleman from Penn probably said it all, because I mean, I think the thing about fiction is that it takes you into the story, it takes you to the inner workings of that world, and it takes you behind the news story and makes you see people as human beings, as complicated human beings, and then you realize that, well, they're actually no different from me, that most people have childhoods and parents and, you know, fall in love at some point. And I think that it's the portrait of the minutiae of living in a situation that is important. That I think fiction can really do a really important thing.
Right there. Your question, please.
So I guess I think in North America, like the sort of the Eurocentric worldview is still very strong. Mm-hmm. And I was recently at this event about publishing, sort of, you know, and it was, they're talking about sort of, when you're a person of color, it's really hard to get published in North America. But, you know, and I was just wondering how you've been able to sort of overcome that barrier and get your work, you know, published.
Right, overcoming barriers and getting your work published.
Honestly, I don't know that I think it is necessary. I mean, I've spent a fair bit of time working as an editor as well as a writer, and I don't think it's necessarily harder to get work published. I think there are particular barriers. So specifically, if you are an attractive South Asian young woman and you want to write an arranged marriage story, that's going to be more likely to please editors than many other options that you could write about. Right, and so you have to be kind of aware that there is I was at a panel at AWP, the Associated Writing Programs Conference, and we were all talking about how we all had to write the arranged marriage novel for two reasons. One was that publishers wanted it from us, and second was that we had to write it and get it out of our systems, because we had our own issues with that, and then go on to write other things. And that if you want to tell a story that doesn't fit into the Western narrative about your people or your nation, it's going to be harder. But I feel like that can actually be applied to many, many things. And I would say from an editor's point of view, the reason we don't publish as many writers of color or as many women is because they don't submit as much. They don't write as much. And when they write, they don't send the stories in as much. When they get rejected the first time, they stop submitting again. Right? White men. Sorry, white guys, but on average, white guys will submit and submit and submit and submit, and persistence is key to getting published. Because, you know, you keep writing and you keep getting better, too, right? So there's a reason why story number 20 is the one that finally gets picked up.
No, that's good. There's another question.
In the back there.
Actually, I'm going to build on Natalie's question. I'm just probably targeted to Shyam, but jump in. We talked about barriers. There's external and internal barriers. Shyam, you know, I didn't know Shyam a lot, but 2 years back, somebody talked about saying, let's host Shyam for a recruiting event. And that within this group of people, there was no shortage of the borders, but a group of people. There's a lot of people said, oh, we can't do that. Community would not accept it. There's a lot of barriers within the community. But today we are here and doing a fantastic job, right? And Shyam, you have gone through a lot of barriers. People don't talk about it, barriers within the community. Maybe you can talk a little bit about it, highlight not just the problem, but what do you think the solution, because that's what we want to hear more, the solution, because there could be people in this room who have those barriers and who don't know how to handle those. Maybe the solution is more important, just the value of problem.
Gosh, well, I mean, my approach to barriers is just to plow through. I mean, this mind, because I'm proud to write. That's basically the way I've done. I mean,
such a nice smile.
you just keep pushing. I mean, I've been doing the Goa Literary Festival for 2 years, which is a literary festival in Sri Lanka. I just keep pushing at the government through it. I mean, I just keep pushing and trying to figure out what the line is, but the things you don't know what the line is, which is what makes it all so menacing. But it hasn't stopped me from, you know, doing a panel this year on reconciliation and doing a panel last year on civil war, and then inviting, you know, Dr. Bakke Sotisaranamu to speak on the panel, which is like really waving a red flag at the government. But I just don't know, I just do it. I think that's the thing. I think Sri Lankans just get so frightened, so, I mean, for good reason, get frightened so easily. And sometimes, I don't know, I guess, I just think you just push and you see and you take a chance and you just go as far as you can. But, you know, you be careful because you obviously, you know, Sri Lanka is a difficult place and the diaspora is equally difficult, equally dangerous in its own way. So I don't know, I think you just have to say, well, yeah, those are the barriers and you just go ahead. As the people in this room who have barriers, I mean, I don't know, I have barriers too. You know, I think that, you know, you don't have to agree with other people's choices and whatever their sexuality, which is not a choice, but, you know, you don't have to think, well, whatever you want to think. But what I'm saying is that you don't have to be on my side, but all you have to do is respect that I'm different from you. And that's, I think, all that's really required. So if you, you know, if there's people sitting in this room who do have different takes on any of the stuff you said, that's fine, that's part of life. I mean, we fortunately don't all agree on everything, otherwise it'd be very boring.
Can I? Sorry. I guess I would just add on the sexuality front that often writers censor themselves, right? So Dorothy Allison is a terrific writer. She wrote Bastard on Carolina, which won awards and was made into a great movie. And with really difficult material. And she said in one of her essays that the best writing comes when you're terrified and you push through that and write it anyway. This is something that matters, right? And the readers can tell. The readers will respond to that even if they, you know, disapprove of every choice you've made with your life, they'll respond to the writing, in my experience. And if you are worried about what your mother will think, I mean, my mother has survived so far, you know. She had a tough road, but with me as a daughter. But grandchildren help a lot.
I mean, you're writing a lot. Koom, you also, you know, talk a lot about nipples tonight, you know. When you write your work, do you write with the message in mind, or does it just come out, and whatever the message happens to be, the message happens to be?
I just try to be very honest in my writing. I don't think I really write erotic love scenes. I think they're more awkward sex scenes. There's usually a reason for them being there. They're not gratuitous.
What did your mother say the first time she read your work?
Said she liked it, and there were things about it, but she couldn't tell any of her friends because of the sex scene. And that's the wonderful contradiction. My mother's quite lively. My dad's more subdued, so he kind of, you know, grinned and he said, the writing's really nice. And the first thing, of course, my mom remarked on, the first line of my book is my narrator is talking and he says, who the fuck would want to marry me? And my mom said, you used the word, you know, that word in your first line. I don't know what to say. I mean, talking about struggles and barriers, I mean, sometimes it's just a struggle to get your own family to support what you really want to do. I mean, I think if my dad would have his brothers, he still says, you can still go to night school and become a doctor. You know, that's
at least she wants you to be a doctor.
to he wants to be a doctor. My mother actually keeps calling me up with alternate career choices. Like, still, like, you're so good at arranging flowers, why don't you go to floral design school? You know, so-and-so's sister is a radiology tech, maybe you should look into that. So, I had a point that I was going to make, which was, also that my mother keeps saying, why can't you just write children's books? That is a, dang.
If it comes back to me, I'll grab the mic.
First of all, a great night. Thanks you guys for coming, and thanks for everyone for showing up. And my question is more along the lines of Sri Lankans Without Borders. What do you guys think about Sri Lankans Without Borders? And if you had one piece of advice for us, what would it be?
You got Koom Kankesan here.
I've had a wonderful night, and I really appreciate being here. So once again, I want to reiterate that. I've never heard of Sri Lankans Without Borders before Kumaran contacted me for this. And I think it's an interesting name because it sounds like Doctors Without Borders, and it's very apt because, you know, every Sri Lankan parent assumes their child is going to be so this is the next best thing, right? So Sri Lanka Without Borders. The only thing I would say is I love the fact that so many people came out, but none of my friends could afford to come out, and if I was a reading, I wouldn't have been able to afford to come out either. And I think just a price point that's sort of in between, or you know, you could get so many more people and really pack the loft by doing that.
Three suggestions. Two have to do with price point. I would do sliding scale. I would, and we do that for those our events. And in my experience, everyone who can afford to pays the top end, and there'll be a couple people who can't afford it, and will pay what they can afford. So you don't see a noticeable drop in how much money you make. The other thing is, if you feel like passing the hat, that actually tends to pull in a lot of donations. So I don't have a hat here tonight, but. If we consider this evening the value of literacy, the value of children's literacy, and what you think children being able to read these stories is worth, and if we pass the hat, those of you who can afford to give a little more.
I can pass my shoe.
No, please don't. Maybe they'll find a hat. But I've seen that work really well for fundraising. And the third thing actually has to do with the Facebook page, and I've been talking with some other writers about the fact that this is a difficult and complicated, and it's okay so far, but you're starting to see flame war-y kinds of things happening. And I would recommend that you have a very strong moderation policy, and you need a pool of dedicated volunteer moderators who are going to be there keeping tabs on it and shutting things down when needed, saying we're taking a timeout, everyone go home and breathe for a couple of hours, come back, we'll open it up again. I've been on the net since it started. My blog is one of the three oldest on the internet, and started in December of 95. And I've seen many forums just fall apart because they didn't moderate well. And if you're going to deal with difficult material, you have to.
I have nothing really to say. It's really a delight being here, and.
It's a great event.
It's a great event. I know it's very difficult to put these events
Let's
on.
Let's give it a round of applause.
Yeah. Yeah.
Well, I hope you all enjoyed it, because if you liked it, there are four more just like it. You can buy tickets to them. You can come and see them. The next one, I believe, is in May 9th. So please make sure you're there. We need you to support. You can buy tickets to all four series right now, so you don't have to worry about getting them at the door. You can go get them right there. It's okay. I'm going to wrap this up soon.
Okay.
One thing I learned in radio, when they give you the hope that you will. You know, after we're done here, we're just going to get a few words from Brendan. And once we do that, the authors will all be available to sign their books and talk to you individually. So without further ado, Brendan.
I'm sorry to come in again at the last minute. The petition is passing around at the back. Many people are rightfully skeptical about the power of the petition. And as individuals, I can tell you are useless to me. But as a crowd, you really do matter. And I can have one simple illustration of this fact. 3 years ago when I began at Penn, we had three honorary members, writers like Nazreen Sajdeh, and their collective sentences totaled 110 years. One was a life sentence in Afghanistan, a death sentence in Afghanistan, 25 years in Cuba, and 49 years in Burma. All three of those men are free today. 2 weeks ago in Toronto, I had the pleasure of shaking hands with the man from Burma. The man from Cuba lives in Spain, and I'm not at liberty to disclose where the other man lives. But please sign it. It really does make a difference. Thank you.
So ladies and gentlemen, once again, if we get a nice big, loud round of applause for our authors.